Good evening, good day to all and one. Okay, so today's plan is to record the new tonal material, which I've changed up a little bit. I know I explained it last time, but I'm going to do it a little bit again. What you can see on the screen is this 12 tone row that I chose. Idea is that from C chromatically up to B with no duplicate notes is the, you know, non-repeating notes is a 12 tone row. And I've divided it up into two groups here that kind of sound like melodies. And they okay, I have to set up my mic a little differently so I don't have to press the talk button. Just a minute.
Check 1, 2. Okay, maybe I'll just talk into this mic, which is live anyway. So, all right, so I'll just play that 12 tone row. Sorry, not too warmed up, but that's all you get for the first 12 notes of today. All right, so
where does that leave us? Okay, so then then I'll add a 6 groups of 2. So all I really did here was put the first 6 notes on top of the second 6 notes, and that provides 2, you know, harmonies there. And then four groups of 3, I'll use those chords. I'll build off of what I record today and build those chords in a later section of the piece. And then we'll end up using these really kind of beefy 6-note chords that are kind of clusters at near the end. So that's the plan. I don't think we need this anymore, so I'm going to set it up to record. And what I did was I set up MIDI notes to play behind me so that I can make sure that I'm playing in tune. If I don't play these notes perfectly in tune, then it's going to be annoying for the rest of the session. So these are just a kind of a tuning guide for me while I'm playing. And then I'll just remove the MIDI, the synthesizer notes later, and just leave the trumpet behind. And then I'll do all kinds of things to that trumpet signal. Okay, here we go. Okay, I think I did very badly on that F, so I'm gonna start from there. I'm getting a double buzz on my lips because I'm not warmed up. I know, excuses, right? I think I'm set now. Right, I think that's enough. If some of those other notes seem different, to have different timbres than others, that's fine with me. I don't want all the notes to sound alike. They should have some character, I think. So that's why I'm not doing this again. Of course, having said that, I can always change my mind. All right. So what are we working on now? Okay, that shows what I just recorded. Let's hear it back, just the trumpet. Okay, I think I am going to change my mind. Sounds terrible. Okay, maybe just that first note. I'm not going to keep the entire beginning and end. I'm just going to choose a bit that I like and then replicate it. You can even hear me getting more warmed up as I go along. But that first note looks really sad. Okay, just that first. Okay, I'm really new to Harrison Mix Bus 6, and so this is why it takes me a long time. Another excuse, I'm kind of new at this, so I'm going to try to figure out how to do my first punch in, punch out. Okay, that wasn't so hard to set up after all. Okay. Totally worked. I want more. I'm gonna do it again. Just because. It's not recording. I think that'll do it. Right. Okay, I'm gonna turn off that other mic just because I don't want that hum and stuff in the back. What am I doing? What I'm doing here is just using a reverb with the freeze function to extend these reverberated notes out as long as I want. Sounds like a trumpet player who has infinite lungs without circular breathing. It's kind of cheating, but I use this effect a lot on acoustically recorded sounds. It's a long process. Forgive me for making you sit through all this, but it's part of the process. I could just point and click and write it into the automation, but I've tried that and it doesn't really work that great. It's too detail-y, and I'd rather just edit it later. I'd do it this way, real time, and then just edit it later. This process was much easier in Cubase, I think, but it's probably because I just knew my way around Cubase better than this. I'm sure there's an easier way to do this on Mixbus, but I haven't figured it out yet. So that's how it goes. the plugins for MixBus that I use that didn't come with the package are ones that are free ones, like this Sanford Reverb. It's all kind of, I only grab the free ones, the ones that are open source licensing. So go Creative Commons. I really prefer to do it this way. I know it's way easier to just plug in a synth and, you know, keyboard it out, but with nothing against synthesizers, but you don't get the kind of randomized artifacts in the sound that you can't predict as much as you can with something like doing it this way. So I think it just adds more character and unpredictability to the sound. Like that. That's a perfect example. That's such a beautiful glassy sound that just wouldn't have happened if I used that one patch, a single patch for all these notes. Even if it was the trumpet patch, it's just not going to sound this way unless you do it acoustically and then mess with it. I know there are 100 ways to disagree with all this that I'm saying, but that's just the way I like to do it. And that's the last note of the 12-tone series. The next step is to just a second. Right, the next step is to mix this down. So yeah, I'll have to mix this down into a new track and then import it into this document, and then so I can use it later without having to set these things up every time. Oh, that sounds lovely. This is just the exporting session. I guess it has to run through the paces to know what exactly it's going to sound like. I don't know why we have to hear it. So goofy sounding. All right, so we get a little spectrogram of what it sounds like. So if we want to audition it, we can. We can press play. Really? Doesn't want to play, huh? Well, let's hope it worked, and we'll try it. And there it is. So now we mute the original trumpet track, put it away in case we need. I should probably start a new group of stuff that I just want to close and be done with, but I don't want to erase it. Can I do that? Okay. I'll do that later, but. Let's hear how this baby sounds. Okay, it's a good start. I just wanted to get a nice, about as pure as I want to get it for now, because I'm going to manipulate it a lot later. I'm going to filter it and all that stuff, but it looks, sounds okay. Let's chop it up. Thank you. great. Okay. So now, I want to leave these as they are. But just for... Alright, I'm going to duplicate this just... So let's make that second line the six groups of two. So I think I just have to take first six and put them Oh, I see. It was beyond the end. Okay, this is just kind of haphazardly thrown together. There will be some weird overlapping, but I'm going to listen to that because it's random. It might provide some interesting ideas. Or not. But this is that C sharp E that we see in the beginning of the 6-2 section that's squared there. See, I'm really glad I did it to the tuning track, because that perfect fourth would sound terrible if one of those notes was even a little bit out of tune. They're all a little bit out of tune, but not enough to produce beats, big beats, anyway. So I'm really glad I did that, because they sound pretty in tune. If I had just done this without checking, just with my horn, it would have been all over the place, and I would have to throw it away and start again 8 times. just trying some things preliminarily. Oh, I hear overtones. Ooh, yeah. I like it so far. Yeah, so of course this is 12 groups of two, but they're identical. So we can move these away. Okay, I think that's good enough. I know I got that, so the next bit is 4 plus 3. Or 4 groups of 3. I need to go get my cheat sheet because it's too small on the screen. It's easy for you to see, not for me. Hold on. Right, got it. Okay, what's next? So we need D, G, and A for the first. All right, so I probably should have labeled these for their notes, but I'm not sure exactly how to do that or if that's useful. So I think I'm just going to count my way through and put it together and use my ear. That's right, that's the first triad. C, F, and B flat. Correct. Now D flat, G flat, A flat, which happens to be one half step higher than the first chord. Yeah. Check that, half step lower. Yep, half step apart. And the last one. D sharp, E, and B. That does not sound right. That sounds right. Okay, I think we got it. have a listen, and then we'll take a break. Oh, hi, Mi-san. I can totally hear her in the other room. I can see she's in the chat room, so I said hi. She's like, ah, what, hey? Okay, those are good sounding triads. I like them. All right, we're gonna take a short break and we'll attack the two groups of six, the really meaty chords. All right, see you in a bit. Rightio, we're back. All right, so the last phase of this of today's work, which is record new tonal material, and actually I went a little further than just record, is do the two groups of six. So there we go. So at the bottom of the page. There, that's better, isn't it? Okay, let's do that. So we're gonna need two chords, each with six notes, none of which repeat from these groups. Okay, so let's start from the bottom of the first one. There, isn't that pretty? That's just lovely. And for the last one. I know it's right, but I just want to check. Correct. And here are the last two chords we're going to hear in the piece. Okay, so we've taken care of the tonal material for this piece. We've got it all ready to go. I have a lot to do to arrange it across the piece. Where am I going to put it? How am I going to treat the sounds? What are they going to sound like in the end? It's a lot of decisions to make between here and the end, and I haven't even really messed with the washes behind it yet, or what else I'll add to it. But it's tonally, it's ready to go. It's all planned out. It all works. And this whole thing about using 12 tones and not repeating things, using them in groups with different in different arrangements, different groupings, that's the idea of isomers. And I'm not the first person to deal with this kind of 12-tone thing. It's been going on since the 40s. If you're interested in the real work done, the pioneering work done in 12-tone, it's also called serialism. Check out Arnold Schoenberg, and he had two really brilliant students, Alban Berg and Anton Webern. So check those guys out, and also. Composers have been using these kind of things for a long time. Stockhausen and Messiaen and, oh gosh, so many. Just too many to name. Look it up. But I recommend one of my favorites is... this composer is a Hungarian composer called Georgi Ligeti, and he did some really amazing, terrifying, but also gorgeous music for Stanley Kubrick's 2001 A Space Odyssey. And he's on that soundtrack. And some of the first real modern atonal music that I ever heard was on that movie when I was a kid. And I really recommend it, and it's terrifying and just jaw-droppingly gorgeous at the same time. So check it out if you want to. That's Georgi Ligeti, G-Y-O-R-G-Y, I think. It's a Hungarian name, I don't know how to spell it. Ligeti, L-I-G-E-T-I. So, all right, I think that's all I'm going to do today. We'll come by and mess with all this stuff later. We'll probably lay it out into a format that looks good, sounds good, and we'll just hit the next thing tomorrow, probably. So thank you all for joining, and much love. and we'll see you next time. I'll leave you with the thing we were listening to earlier.